the federal government has the capacity to help open up opportunity and create ladders of opportunity and to create frameworks where the American people can succeed. Look, the genius of America is the free enterprise system and freedom and the fact that people can go out there and start a business, work on an idea, make their own decisions. But as Abraham Lincoln understood, there are also some things we do better together. So in the middle of the Civil War, Abraham Lincoln said, let's help to finance the Transcontinental Railroad. Let's start the National Academy of Sciences. Let's start land-grant colleges, because we want to give these gateways of opportunity for all Americans, because if all Americans are getting opportunity, we're all going to be better off. That doesn't restrict people's freedom. That enhances it. And so what I've tried to do as president is to apply those same principles. And when it comes to education, what I've said is we've got to reform schools that are not working. We used something called Race to the Top. It wasn't a top-down approach, Governor. What we've said is to states, we'll give you more money if you initiate reforms. And as a consequence, you had 46 states around the country who have made a real difference. But what I've also said is, let's hire another 100,000 math and science teachers to make sure we maintain our technological lead and our people are skilled and able to succeed. And hard-pressed states right now can't all do that. In fact, we've seen layoffs of hundreds of thousands of teachers over the last several years. And Governor Romney doesn't think we need more teachers. I do, because I think that that is the kind of investment where the federal government can help. It can't do it all, but it can make a difference. And as a consequence, we'll have a better trained workforce. And that will create jobs because companies want to locate in places where we've got a skilled workforce.
2 minutes, Governor, on the role of government. Your view.
Well, first, I love great schools. Massachusetts, our schools are ranked number one of all 50 states. And the key to great schools, great teachers. So I reject the idea that I don't believe in great teachers or more teachers. Every school district, every state should make that decision on their own. The role of government. Look behind us. The Constitution and the Declaration of Independence. The role of government is to promote and protect the principles of those documents. First, life and liberty. We have a responsibility to protect the lives and liberties of our people, and that means a military second to none. I do not believe in cutting our military. I believe in maintaining the strength of America's military. Second, in that line that says we are endowed by our Creator with our rights, I believe we must maintain our commitment to religious tolerance and freedom in this country. That statement also says that we are endowed by our Creator with the right to pursue happiness as we choose. I interpret that as, one, making sure that those people who are less fortunate and can't care for themselves are cared by one another. We're a nation that believes that we're all children of the same God, and we care for those that have difficulties, those that are elderly and have problems and challenges, those that are disabled. We care for them, and we look for discovery and innovation, all these things desired out of the American heart to provide the pursuit of happiness for our citizens. But we also believe in maintaining for individuals the right to pursue their dreams and not to have the government substitute itself for the rights of free individuals. And what we're seeing right now is, in my view, a trickle-down government approach, which has government thinking it can do a better job than free people pursuing their dreams. And it's not working. And the proof of that is 23 million people out of work. The proof of that is one out of six people in poverty. The proof of that is we've gone from 32 million on food stamps to 47 million on food stamps. The proof of that is that 50% of college graduates this year can't find work. We know that the path we're taking is not working. It's time for a new path.
All right, let's go through some specifics in terms of how each of you views the role of government. Education. Does the federal government have a responsibility to improve the quality of public education in America?
Well, the primary responsibility for education is of course, at the state and local level. But the federal government also can play a very important role. And I agree with Secretary Arne Duncan. He's some ideas he's put forward on Race to the Top, not all of them, but some of them I agree with and congratulate him for pursuing that. The federal government can get local and state schools to do a better job. My own view, by the way, is I've added to that. I happen to believe I want the kids that are getting federal dollars from IDEA or Title I, these are disabled kids or poor kids or lower income kids, rather. I want them to be able to go to the school of their choice. So all federal funds, instead of going to the state or to the school district, I'd have go, if you will, follow the child and let the parent and the child decide where to send their student.
How do you see the federal government's responsibility to, as I say, to improve the quality of public education in this country?
Well, as I've indicated, I think that it has a significant role to play. Through our Race to the Top program, we've worked with Republican and Democratic governors to initiate major reforms, and they're having an impact right now.
Do you think you have a difference with your views and those of Governor Romney on about education? And
you know, this is where budgets matter, because budgets reflect choices. So when Governor Romney indicates that he wants to cut taxes and potentially benefit folks like me and him, and to pay for it, we're having to initiate significant cuts in federal support for education, that makes a difference. You know, his running mate, Congressman Ryan, put forward a budget that reflects many of the principles that Governor Romney's talked about. And it wasn't very detailed. This seems to be a trend. But what it did do is to, if you extrapolated how much money we're talking about, you'd look at cutting the education budget by up to 20%. When it comes to community colleges, we are seeing great work done out there all over the country, because we have the opportunity to train people for jobs that exist right now. And one of the things I suspect Governor Romney and I probably agree on is getting businesses to work with community colleges so that they're setting up their training programs.
Do you agree, Governor?
Let me just finish the point. I suspect it'll be a small
going very well in my state, by the way. Yeah.
Where they're partnering so that they're designing training programs, and people who are going through them know that there's a job waiting for them if they complete.
Okay.
That makes a big difference, but that requires some federal support. Let me just say one final example. When it comes to making college affordable, whether it's 2-year or 4-year, one of the things that I did as president was we were sending $60 billion to banks and lenders as middlemen for the student loan program, even though the loans were guaranteed. So there was no risk for the banks or the lenders, but they were taking billions out of the system. And we said, why not cut out the middleman? And as a consequence, what we've been able to do is to provide millions more students assistance, lower keep low interest rates on student loans. And this is an example of where our priorities make a difference. Governor Romney, I genuinely believe, cares about education. But when he tells a student that, you know, you should borrow money from your parents to go to college, you know, that indicates the degree to which there may not be as much of a focus on the fact that folks like myself, folks like Michelle, kids who attend University of Denver, just don't have that option. And for us to be able to make sure that they've got that opportunity and they can walk through that door, that is vitally important, not just to those kids. It's how we're going to grow this economy over the long term.
We're running out of time, gentlemen. So I think you have a chance. Respond to that.
Mr. President, you're entitled as a president to your own airplane and to your own house, but not to your own facts. All right. I'm not going to cut education funding. I don't have any plan to cut education funding and grants that go to people going to college. I'm planning on continuing to grow, so I'm not planning on making changes there. But you make a very good point, which is that the place you put your money makes a pretty clear indication of where your heart is. You put $90 billion into green jobs. And I'm all in favor of green energy. $90 billion. That would have hired 2 million teachers. $90 billion. And these businesses, many of them have gone out of business. I think about half of them, of the ones that have been invested in, have gone out of business. A number of them happen to be owned by people who are contributors to your campaigns. Look, the right course for America's government, we're talking about the role of government, is not to become the economic player, picking winners and losers, telling people what kind of health treatment they can receive, taking over the health care system that has existed in this country for a long, long time and has produced the best health records in the world. The right answer for government is to say, how do we make the private sector become more efficient and more effective? How do we get schools to be more competitive? Let's grade them. I propose we grade our schools so parents know which schools are succeeding and failing, so they can take their child to a school that's being more successful. I don't want to cut our commitment to education. I wanted to make it more effective and efficient. And by the way, I've had that experience. I don't just talk about it. I've been there. Massachusetts schools are ranked number one in the nation. This is not because I didn't have commitment to education. It's because I care about education for all of our kids.
All right, gentlemen, look, excuse me one sec. Look, excuse me, sir. We've got barely have 3 minutes left. I'm not going to grade the two of you and say your answers have been too long or I've done a poor job.
You've done a great job.
Oh, well, no. But the fact is, government, the role of government and governing, we've lost a pod, in other words. So we only have three minutes left in the debate before we go to your closing statements. And so I want to ask finally here, and remember, we got 3 minutes total time here. And the question is this. Many of the legislative functions of the federal government right now are in a state of paralysis as a result of partisan gridlock. If elected, in your case, if reelected in your case, what would you do about that? Governor?
Jim, I had the great experience, it didn't seem like it at the time, of being elected in a state where my legislature was 87% Democrat. And that meant I figured out from day one I had to get along, and I had to work across the aisle to get anything done. We drove our schools to be number one in the nation. We cut taxes 19 times.
What would you do as president?
As president, I will sit down on day one, actually the day after I get elected, I'll sit down with leaders, the Democratic leaders, as well as Republican leaders, and continue, as we did in my state. We met every Monday for a couple hours, talked about the issues and the challenges in our state in that case. We have to work on a collaborative basis, not because we're going to compromise our principle, but because there's common ground and the challenges America faces right now. Look, the reason I'm in this race is there are people that are really hurting today in this country. And we face this deficit could crush the future generations. What's happening in the Middle East? There are developments around the world that are of real concern. And Republicans and Democrats both love America, but we need to have leadership in Washington that will actually bring people together and get the job done, and could not care less if it's a Republican or a Democrat. I've done it before. I'll do it again.
Mr. President.
Well, first of all, I think Governor Romney is going to have a busy first day because he's also going to repeal Obamacare, which will not be very popular among Democrats as you're sitting down with him. But look, my philosophy has been I will take ideas from anybody, Democrat or Republican, as long as they're advancing the cause of making middle-class families stronger and giving ladders of opportunity into the middle class. That's how we cut taxes for middle-class families and small businesses. That's how we cut $1 trillion of spending that wasn't advancing that cause. That's how we signed 3 trade deals into law that are helping us to double our exports and sell more American products around the world. That's how we repealed Don't Ask, Don't Tell. That's how we ended the war in Iraq, as I promised, and that's how we're going to wind down the war in Afghanistan. That's how we went after Al-Qaeda and bin Laden. So we've seen progress even under Republican control of the House of Representatives. But ultimately, part of being principled, part of being a leader is, A, being able to describe exactly what it is that you intend to do, not just saying, I'll sit down, but you have to have a plan. Number two. What's important is occasionally you've got to say no to folks both in your own party and in the other party. And, you know, yes, have we had some fights between me and the Republicans when they fought back against us reining in the excesses of Wall Street? Absolutely, because that was a fight that needed to be had. When we were fighting about whether or not we were going to make sure that Americans had more security with their health insurance, and they said no, yes, that was a fight that we needed to have.
All right.
And so part of leadership and governing is both saying what it is that you are for, but also being willing to say no to some things. And I've got to tell you, Governor Romney, when it comes to his own party during the course of this campaign, has not displayed that willingness to say no to some of the more extreme parts of his party.
That brings us to closing statements. There's a coin toss. Governor Romney, you won the toss, and you...